This video presents solutions and options to the data sufficiency challenge one that we ran. We ran two challenges in December. So this is the first of the challenges. What is this challenge? I presented you guys with a question stem. The challenge was to come up with two statements. It's not just two statements. You actually need to come up with five sets of two statements. One each that corresponded to answer choices A, B, C, D, and E of data sufficiency. So through open this challenge, I had responses from four of you, and basically I took statements from three of you to discuss this video. I've added a statement that I've added to it. So in this video, as a response to this challenge, solution to this challenge, I've divided this video into four parts. This video is part one. In part one, we're just looking at statements that correspond to the answer choices A or B. Essentially, if one of the two statements is sufficient and the other one is not sufficient, I picked those cases. Essentially, if you swap 1 and 2, you're going to get choice A or choice B. I picked all those statements that match this condition, and I'm discussing that here. I've picked statements from three of you who responded to it. The three people whose statements I've used are Niranjana Ajith, Premkumar Kamaraj, and Aditya Adlawar. Congrats, guys. Beautiful statements. We'll be discussing them as part of this video. But before we get started, let's get some clarity on what the question stem says. It says the three numbers are distinct real numbers. Keep that in mind. They are distinct. A is not equal to B is not equal to C. The second part, let's invest a little bit of time in understanding what it means. It says modulus of A minus B equals 2 times modulus of B minus C. Getting a hold on this, getting a good understanding of this is very crucial to cracking this question in making the statements for it. Let's get started with that part. Modulus of A minus B, what does it mean? It tells us the difference between two numbers A and B. Right? A could be greater than B, B could be greater than A, it doesn't matter. Modulus of A minus B tells us the difference between these two numbers. It says that the difference between A and B is 2 times the difference between B and C. Let's work out what all scenarios will make this happen. I'm going to enumerate a couple of scenarios. I'm going to pause at the end of the second one. You check out whether more exist and then come back to it. Start with the first one. Here is B. A is to the left of B and C is to the right of B. The difference between B and A, let's say, is 2x, and the difference between B and C is x. So this satisfies this condition with B being in between A and C. This is case 1. Case 2 is very simple. Swap the C and A. C is to the left of B. The difference between B and C, let's say, is x. The difference between B and A is 2x and A is to the right of B. So cases 1 and 2. Once you have figured out case 1, if you swap A and C, you've got case 2. Are these the only two ones? Pause the video here. Think about it. Check out what other possibilities could exist. If they exist, note them down. If they do not exist, then play the video. If it exists, you'll see the cases here. If they do not exist, we're obviously going to go into the statements presented by me. They do exist. Let's look at case 3. In case 3, C lies between B and A. A is the largest, C is the least, B is the least. C lies exactly at the midpoint of A and B. So the difference between B and C is Y. The difference between B and A is equal to 2Y. Look at something like this. This could be a 4, this could be a 6, and this could be an 8. So case 3 is done. Once you've done case 3, case 4 is very simple. Swap the places of A and B, right? A is to the left of C, B is to the right of C. The gap between B and C is a Y. The gap between A and B is a 2Y. It satisfies this condition. In cases 1 and 2, we have B as the median. In cases 3 and 4, we have C as the median. Take a minute, check out, can you have A as the median? Is this a possibility? I'm saying it's not possible. Check out why it's not possible. Reason out and then move on. Right? Having got this clarity, all of the statements presented, we'll be evaluating them in light of these four possibilities, in light of these four cases. Let's get started with the first of the questions, statements presented. This is presented by us, Wizako. Statement 1 says, product of ABC is negative, such that median C equals 3 times modulus of B. Statement 2 is, B is greater than A. Let's evaluate. Before we evaluate, let's do the template questions and then move on to the statement. The first one is, what is this question? It's a, how many of these numbers are positive? How many is the crux? How will the answer to this question be? It's going to be a number. It's going to be 1 or 2 or all 3 or none. So it's going to be a number ranging from 0 to 3, all being integers. When is the data sufficient? If you're able to come up with a unique value. If you're able to say 2 of these numbers are positive, 1 is negative. Or you could say all 3 are positive, all 3 are negative. You need to come up with a unique answer using the information in the statements. In that case, the data is sufficient. If you're not getting a unique value, if you're saying that it could be 2, it could be 3, I'm not sure, which is when the data is not sufficient. Let's get started with the first statement. First statement packs in too much information. Let's break it one by one. It says the product of these three numbers is negative. When will the product of three numbers be negative? Product of three numbers will be negative when all three of them are negative. Negative into negative into negative is negative. Done. It is also possible when two of them are positive and one is negative. So essentially, from the first part of statement one, we have two possibilities arising and only two. We don't have any more. So we are not getting a unique answer, but you narrowed down our answers in the first part to it could either be two or it could be zero, right? Two numbers are positive or none of the numbers is positive. So that is going to be your answer. Let's move on to the second bit of this. It says median C is equal to 3 times modulus of B. Median is C. Recall the cases that we had. In cases 1 and 2, we basically had B as the median. Cases 3 and 4 is where we had C as the median. I'm putting them down for our quick reference. So C is here, A is to the right of C and B is to the right of, B is to the left of C in case 3. Case 4, A and B are swap places. Now let's look at what other information we have. We have this information that C is equal to 3 times modulus of B. Modulus of B will always be a positive number, which means that we can conclude that C is positive. Right, so that is done. In both these cases, we have C as positive. C is a positive number, which is 3 times another number, which means that C has to be greater than B. It cannot be otherwise. You can't have a case that C is 3 times B and B is to the right of C on the number line. So case 4 is an infeasible solution with this part of the statement. So we know that C is the median, so 3 and 4 existed. And we know C is equal to 3 times modulus of B, which means that we know C is positive. Because C is positive and C is 3 times modulus of B, B cannot be to the right of C. So case 4 is also ruled out. So now what do we have? We have C as positive. A is to the right of C, so A also will be positive. We know that either two numbers are positive or none of them is positive. We have two numbers as positive, so none positive does not exist. The product has to be negative. We need to have at least one of these numbers being negative, and that happens to be B. So from statement one, do we have a conclusive answer? From statement one, yes, we have a conclusive answer that two of these numbers are positive numbers and one is negative. So statement one is sufficient. Quickly run through this entire discussion, summarizing it in a printed form in the next slide. C is the median, only cases 3 and 4 existed. That is something that we figured out. Next part of the statement said, C is equal to 3 times modulus of B. Modulus of B is positive, which means C is positive. C is positive and C is 3 times B, modulus of B, which means that B cannot be to the right of C. C has to be to the right of B, which means C is greater than B. That rules out possibility 4. So case 3 is the only one that's feasible. In case 3, we have A being greater than C, which means that A is also positive. So we know A is positive, we know C is positive. The product has to be negative, then at least one of the numbers should be negative, and that is B. So in ABC, because the product is negative, B is negative, A and C are positive. We have a conclusive answer that two of these numbers are positive. We have a definite answer with statement one. One alone is sufficient. Can we eliminate some answer choices? Oh yeah, certainly we can eliminate quite a lot of them. We'll eliminate B, C, E. Our answer choices basically narrow down to A or D. Move on to statement 2. Let's evaluate statement 2 alone. It says B is greater than A. Let's look at what possibilities exist. All three numbers could be negative with B being greater than A. Just look at one example, right? B is greater than A. A is here. We can put C to this side of it. So this B is equal to basically a minus 4. This number is a minus 6. This is a minus 3. The difference between B and A is twice the difference between B and C. This condition is satisfied that was initially stated. All three numbers are negative. Can all three numbers be positive? It's another possibility. Let's take B here. Let's keep A and C. Same order. I'm not changing it. Let's take B to be a 4, A to be equal to a 2, and C to be equal to a 5. Difference between B and C is twice the difference between B and A. So all three are positive. All three could be negative. All three could be positive. There are other possibilities also that exist. We don't have a unique answer with statement 2 is the crux of it. At the end of evaluating statement 1, we narrow down our answer choices to A or D. Statement 2 alone is not sufficient. Rule out D. Choice A is the answer. Right? Shall we move on to the second bit? Let's go to the statement presented by Niranjana Ajith. This is a statement given by her. Statement 1 is A is greater than B. BC is less than 0. She's beautifully got a second statement where A is still greater than B. She has swapped BC being greater than 0. We'll have to check out which of these two statements is sufficient. Pause the video here. Evaluate these two statements. Check out whether the answer is A or the answer is B. Right? I said I picked all those cases where one is sufficient and the other is not. I did not tell you which one is sufficient. Right? Check this out. Come back to the video to check things. Did you do it? Did you figure out the answer? Let's get started with first of our statements. It says A is greater than B. of the four cases, again, go back to that slide if you have, right? Or check your notepad if you have noted things down. In which all cases was A greater than B? In cases 2 and 3, A was to the right of B. Now, these are the two cases which work. And in this case, we also have one added information that BC is less than 0. Let's look at statement 2. In statement 2, the way it is given, B is to the right of C, which means B is a larger number. The product of these two numbers is negative. One of them should be positive, the other should be negative. B is greater, so let's say this is 0 somewhere here. B is positive, C is negative. So this number is positive, this number is negative. A is further to the right of B, which means A also should be positive. So in case 2, with B being greater than C and BC being less than 0, how many of these numbers are positive? We get a number which is equal to 2. Quickly summarizing it, BC is negative. Because B is greater than C, we have B to be positive, C to be negative. A is further to the right of B, which means that A and B are positive. Two of these numbers are positive. Look at case 3. In case 3, we have C being greater than B. Product of BC is negative. One of them should be positive, one of them should be negative. Obviously points to the fact that 0 is between B and C. C is positive. Because C is positive and we know that B has to be negative, A is further to the right of C, A will also be positive. In this scenario also, how many of these numbers are positive? We get an answer, 2 of these numbers are positive. In one case, we had A and B as positive. In another case, you're having A and C are positive. That is not the question. The question is, how many of them are positive? In both these cases, case 2 or case 3, we end up getting the same unique answer. 2 of these numbers are positive. So statement 1 has given us a unique answer. So statement 1 alone is sufficient. It's told us 2 of these numbers are positive. Quickly summarize it in a printed form. Said that A is greater than B and BC is less than 0. A is greater than B happens only in two cases, 2 and 3. In case 2, we have B being greater than C. If the product BC is negative, one of them should be positive, one of them should be negative. B is a larger number, so B is positive and C is negative. A is greater than B, which is further to the right of B, which means that A also has to be positive. Two of these numbers are positive is what we get with case 2. In case 3, it's exactly the reverse. C is to the right of B. One of the numbers between B and C should be positive, the other should be negative. So C is positive, B is negative. A is further to the right of C, so A also has to be positive. A and C are positive, two numbers are positive. We have the same unique numbers, two of them are positive using statement 1. One alone is sufficient. So can we eliminate some answer choices? Yes. If statement 1 alone is sufficient, answer choices basically boil down to A or D. Let's evaluate statement 2 alone before we decide whether it's A or whether it's D. Pretty much same to a large extent, BC is positive is what she has given as the second statement. So because A is greater than B, cases 2 and 3 will still hold good for us. Right? The question says BC is greater than 0, which means that either both B and C are positive or both B and C are negative. Let's start with just case 2. Both B and C are negative. If that be the case, how many of these numbers are positive? I'm just drawing 0 to be here. 0 can very well be here. I'm just looking at one scenario. In this scenario, if B and C are negative, B is negative, C is negative, we have one number that is positive. It could also happen in the same case too, that all of them are positive. Because BC is positive, BC is greater than 0, can happen with both the numbers being positive. So 0 is here, C is positive, B is positive, A is further to the right, which means this is also positive. If this happened to be the case, then we'll have all three numbers being positive. So case 2 itself, we got two possibilities. I can look at a scenario where two of them are negative, one is positive. I can also have an example where all of them are negative. Let's not even bother about it right now. And there's a second scenario where we have all three of them being positive. We do not have a unique answer with statement 2. With statement 2. In case 2 itself, it failed. We don't even have to check for case 3 because case 2, if it had given us a unique answer, we'd have to check whether case 3 is also giving us a unique answer. Case 2 did not give us a unique answer. So we can throw away statement 2, can trash statement 2 saying that it's not giving us a unique answer. It could be 1, it could be 3, it could even be none. That's a third possibility. Check that out also. Statement 2 is not giving us a unique answer. At the end of evaluating statement 1, our answer choices were down to A or D. 2 is not sufficient. Our answer choices, basically A. Eliminate choice D. Quickly summarize it in a printed form. Either both B and C could be positive or both B and B C could be negative. So we are starting with a maximum of one of these numbers being negative, right? Sorry, both B and C could be positive, in which case all three could be positive. If both B and C are negative, we could have a scenario that A is positive, which means one of them is positive, or A could also be negative, which means all of them are negative. So you're ending up with more than one answer choice, 0 or 1 or 3. You're not having a unique answer with statement 2. 2 alone is not sufficient. Eliminate D, choice A is the answer. The beauty about the way she has framed the statement is, she's just tweaked this one bit to essentially change statement 2 as not being sufficient and statement 1 being sufficient. Let's look at the third set of statements. This is presented to us by Premkumar Kamaraj. Statement 1 is modulus of B minus C equals 1, B plus 4 equals 0. Statement 2 is B equals 2. Let's get started with statement 1. You guys evaluate both of these, check out whether the answer is A or B. Come back to the video to check out what it is. We've done that. I'm going to get into statement 1. From this part, I know B equals minus 4. B equals minus 4 is one number given, and we know that the difference between B and C equals 1. Let's plant it in all four scenarios and check out if you get a uniform answer. Case 1, B is equal to minus 4. The difference between B and C is 1. In case 1, C is to the right of B, so C will be equal to minus 3. Right? The number A should be, the difference between B and A should be twice the difference between B and C. So this is going to be 2 lesser than this, which is going to be minus 6. We don't even have to compute this value. If B is negative and C is negative, A, which is to the left, will also be negative. How many of these numbers are negative which satisfy the condition in the statement and the fact that case 1 is also satisfied? We have all three numbers being negative, which means how many of them are positive? 0 numbers are positive. So move on to case 2. In case 2, we have swapped A and B, A and C. B is equal to minus 4. C is 1 lesser than that, which is going to be minus 5. A is 2 greater than that, which is going to be minus 2. How many of these numbers are positive? 0 of them are positive in case 2 as well. So more to case 3. Case 3, C is the middle number. B is equal to minus 4. Difference between B and C is 1. C is to the right of B, so this is going to be minus 3. The difference between B and A is twice the difference between B and C, so that has to be a 2. And A is 2 further to the right of C, so this is going to be equal to minus 2. How many of these numbers are positive? We have 0 numbers as positive. The last scenario, we are swapping the values of A and B. We have B to be equal to minus 4. C and A are to the left of B. So these will also be negative. Don't even bother computing the value. So how many of these numbers are positive? 0 numbers are positive. We know there are only 4 cases. Plugging in the data from statement 1, we found out that 0 of these numbers are positive. We got a unique value with statement 1. Statement 1 alone is sufficient. Quickly summarize it. Given values that you'll get in all 4 cases when B equals minus 4 and the difference between B and C equals 1. In all of these 4 cases, you've got a uniform value that all the numbers are negative, none of the numbers is positive. So statement 1 alone is sufficient. If 1 alone is sufficient, we can narrow down our answer choices to basically A or D. Quickly summarize it, evaluate statement 2 to decide whether it is A or D. Statement 2 says B equals 2. I'm going to look at a counterexample. It's a very easy statement to trash. Right. Basically, look at A, B equals 2. A is 4 less than that, which means the gap between B and A is equal to 4. Gap between B and C should be a 2. I've added 2 to it. So the approach is basically A, B, C. This is a 2, this is a minus 2, and this number is a 4. The gap here is 4, the gap here is 2. Satisfies all conditions. How many numbers are positive? 2 of them are positive. Let's get a counterexample. I've taken B to be equal to 2. B is equal to 2. A is equal to 4 in this example, and C is equal to 3. So C lies in between these two numbers. B to C, the difference is 1. B to A, the difference is 2. All numbers are positive. We're not getting a unique answer with statement 2. 2 alone is not sufficient. At the end of evaluating statement 1, our answer choices are basically down to A or D because 1 was sufficient. 2 is not sufficient. Eliminate D. Choice A is the answer. Let's move on to the last of the statements given. This is given by Aditya Adlawar. Statement given by him is A, B and C are roots of this cubic equation. Statement 2 is B cube equals 64. Look like quite an intensive statement that way. How do we find out the roots of a cubic equation? The first root, you'll have to find it out by trial and error. Let's say x equals 1. Let's start with that. If 1 happened to be a root of this equation, then you plug in x equals 1 in this, you'll essentially get this value to be equal to 0. Let's do that and see. When I substitute x equals 1, I'm getting a value which is equal to minus 8, which is not equal to 0, which means 1 is not a root. Move on to the next number. Let's try if 2 is a root. When I substitute x equals 2, it becomes 0. So we quickly found out that x equals 2 is a root to this equation. If x equals 2 is a root to this equation, x minus 2 will divide this, which means this cubic expression can be written as x minus 2 into some other expression in x. Now, how do we find out this f of x? x minus 2 and f of x is equal to this cubic equation. So if I divide this cubic equation by x minus 2, I'll get the value of f of x. You can do it in two ways. One is a long division method. The second is a synthetic division. In synthetic division, this is a synthetic division method. I'm going to pick up the coefficients of all of these numbers. 1, minus 10, 31, and minus 3. The root is 2. So write this 1 as it is, the first coefficient as it is. 2 into 1 equals 2. Minus 10 plus 2 is equal to minus 8. 2 into minus 8 is a minus 16. 31 minus 16 is a 15. 2 into 15 is a 30. Minus 30 plus 30 equals 0. Now, we'll start from the right-hand side. Plug in 15 as a coefficient for x power 0. X power 0 is a 1, so this is going to be 15. This is a constant term. Now, minus 8, plug in the minus 8 as a coefficient of x power 1. So, that's going to become minus 8x. Plug in 1 as a coefficient for x square. So, this is equal to x square minus 8x plus 15. So, f of x for us is equal to this. So, x minus 2 into x square minus 8x plus 15 equals 0. This part can further be broken down by splitting the middle term. That's a straightforward case. It's a very easy number to split as x minus 3 into x minus 5. So, x minus 2 into x minus 3 into x minus 5 equals 0. The roots are 2, 5 and 3. What did the statement say about A, B and C? It said A, B and C are the roots of this equation. How many of them are positive? All three are positive. So, statement 1 is sufficient. This was a difficult statement. Or was it? Did we do the right thing? Hold on. In DS, do you have to find the values or is it enough if you know that you could have found the values? It would have been enough if we could have conclusively said that I can determine how many of these numbers are positive without actually computing it. How does one go about it? This is a cubic equation. All the coefficients are known. So this is going to have three roots. That is definitely known to us. The roots are A, B and C is what the statement says. These three roots could be any number, yeah? It could be a 4, minus 18 and 243. Doesn't matter what those numbers are. But these three numbers are three unique numbers. In these three unique numbers, we can count how many of them are positive and therefore the final answer is going to be a unique value. We will not know what it is unless we actually went about this. This is not a problem solving question. This is a data sufficiency question. It would have been enough to reason it that way and you should not have done anything. If you had done this, that's criminal. That's a criminal waste of 3 minutes of your time. That's probably criminal in thinking that what a difficult question this is. While this is actually probably not such a difficult statement because all that they were looking for is can you reason out and get a unique value. Right? If you get this, remember this every time. If you can get a unique value without actually finding out what those are, that's enough from a data sufficiency perspective. So net-net, we have statement 1 being sufficient. Statement 1 is sufficient. Rule out choices, BCE, our answer choices will basically boil down to A or D. So evaluate statement 2 to determine whether it is A or D. B cube equals 64, so B equals 4. I'm going to use counterexample. It's very easy to find a counterexample, right? This is one set of value I'm giving. You guys will be able to find out umpteen values, right? B equals 4. C is 2 less than that. A is 4 more than that. All of them are positive. B is equal to 4. C is equal to 6 less than that. So A should be twice more than that. It's 12 more than that. So this also satisfies all the conditions given in the statement. We have 2 positive, 1 negative. So we're not getting a unique answer with statement 2. At the end of evaluating statement 1, our answer choices were down to A or D. Eliminate D because B statement 2 is not sufficient. Choice A is the answer. In all these 4 examples, we had choice A as the answer. Great job, Niranjana, Prem, and Aditya Adlawar, right? In the next video, in part 2, we'll be looking at statements from some of you which match the condition that the answer choice is C. Guys, have you tried Wizako's online GMAT quant course? Right, it's available at wzko.in.core. It starts from absolute basics, builds the logic intuitively and takes you to the challenging level questions which could get you a Q50 plus in the GMAT quant. Get started today. Sign up as a trial user in this URL. Statistics and average is free. Get started with it, build momentum. You need to invest 6 to 8 hours to complete the topic. Once you have built momentum, you can convert it into a paid course and get access to all the questions and tests in it. Before you leave, subscribe to this channel, youtube.com/Wizako, to get GMAT prep updates. Best wishes.